Counting down from 5, 4, 3, 2.
Welcome to the show known as Conversations with Ralph Walker. Have you ever wondered about the early history of Monrovia? I mean, like way back in the day, before there were even roads, or maybe it was just a big grove of big old trees everywhere you could look, rolling hills and all of that. And the word I was searching for in the mighty oaks that caught many of eyes on hot days. Well, today I have a very special guest here today, Richard Singer. He's here today, former employee of Monrovia, California, now somewhat retired. He's on to his second book, 1887, and it is quite interesting. I just finished reading it, and I'm glad to have you in the studio today. Dick, how are you doing today?
Doing real well, thank you, Ralph.
You have me a bit nervous.
I do. Believe, yeah. I have you nervous.
Yeah. Oh. Believe
we got,
it or not.
We got a problem right off the bat.
Okay. How have you been doing with yourself first and foremost?
Real good. Real good. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Life is good these days. I've got time to do things like this.
All right. So how long did it take for you to get started on the book?
It took, I worked about a year and a half on it total. One year of research and writing and another year of fact checking and rewriting and then proofreading and such, but it was about an 18-month project.
All right, what made you want to write the book, 1887? That's a little bit before both our time.
Yeah, well, I have some time on my hands, and writing is something I do, and this particular subject has been fascinating me for a while. I wrote the last book, Renaissance Years, which covered some of this real quick. Mm-hmm. You know, I just went past it into the meat of what I was writing about. But there were things about this that always fascinated me, about the years 1886, 87, mm-hmm. 88, when the city was first forming, when it went, as you were explaining, from a hillside covered with oaks and sagebrush to a city of 2,000 people with industry and business and not just residences, but residential neighborhoods, mm-hmm. With a social strata, a community cohesiveness, mm-hmm. built around organizations and entertainments and churches and various clubs. It was a fascinating story. It all happened in 18 months, the same as it took me to write the book, actually.
Which is crazy when you think of such a tremendous economical boom.
Yes, yeah.
This part of town on top of that, and people coming from as far as Canada, or you name it.
They were coming from New Zealand. People came from everywhere to California at that time. There was a massive migration. More people were coming west of the Mississippi at that point than at any time in America's history, as far as migration was concerned. There was just a flow of people to the west because the railroads had come through.
Yes.
And it opened it up.
Yes, yes.
Once that happened, land became very cheap and very productive. California farmland could outproduce farmland in the Midwest.
No winter.
Exactly. So you had three seasons here where you had one there.
Okay. And that's interesting that you divided the book up into seasons.
Yeah, how else do you divide up a year? I was thinking, you know, I didn't want to do it week by week or month by month, but the seasons seem to have a turn to them.
Yes.
And you can see events starting to take shape on a seasonal basis.
And so, it's a time indicator.
Yes, very much so. Very much so.
Something I learned coming out here that you don't have it.
That's right. Yeah, we have to create it in books.
Or a film shoot. The fall of the year with some liquid amber trees, and then we mm-hmm. have a sense of fall. But otherwise,
right.
it's
and this is what struck. Sunshine. This is what struck the original. I don't want to call them pioneers because they weren't, but in that sense, those first arrivals here, they were coming from the east and the Midwest, and they were used to winters and they were used to falls. Spring was very different for them than it was here. Summer was very different. And the weather was what was attracting them to it. Wasn't just the opportunity and to make money off of farmland and such, mm-hmm. but it was the weather that was behind that whole thing.
The drawing factor.
Which is still the drawing factor.
Yes, even to this
it's
day.
It's why my family's here. It's why my wife's family's right. here. It's why right. an entire generation did it again in the 1940s and 50s.
Same reason why I left Chicago.
Exactly.
It was those winters were just unbearable, not to mention what it must have been like back then.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
wood to make a fire, you were in trouble.
That's right. That's right. Matter of fact, there's a character in the book who talks about what it cost in the winter to sit at home and burn wood as compared to what you're doing out here when you're growing walnuts.
Yeah. All right, let's dive right into it.
Let's
jump to Early Monroe, Mr. Monroe himself. As a young man, he was involved in the Civil War?
Yes. Yeah, he was a lieutenant in it was the 7th Iowa. They were a volunteer group. It was a militia. They were conscripted. Well, they were volunteers. I didn't say they were conscripted, but they were a part of the Union Army.
Yes.
On a statewide basis, but they were protecting the western frontier. So he did a lot of riding up and down through Missouri, Oklahoma, Kansas, Iowa, that area, chasing Confederates, breaking up Confederate recruiting efforts. They fought Quantrell's Raiders at one point, got them on the run. I don't know the battles that he may or may not have been in, but I know they were active at that point. He later went into another outfit that was formed after that. He was made a lieutenant at that point. He went in as a private, was made a lieutenant. He was in charge at one point of moving a bunch of Sioux Indians to a reservation in, I think it was Montana or Wyoming.
Yes, Which I thought that was quite interesting with the backdrop of what was going on today.
Yes.
I mean, it was like, what a coincidence.
Yes.
And what timing.
Oh, yeah. But history is like that. It overlaps constantly, and we can find our parallels. And that's what's wonderful about writing these. There's a constant reminder of how undifferent today is from what it was. I came out here on a train on the Santa Fe, the same as the people in that book did.
Yes.
I moved into a brand new city that was just being formed in brand new tract in my parents' first home, and went to school with kids from all over the country who all arrived there at the same time too. It was the same experience, I realized, that I was writing about in 1887.
And you find yourself living it.
And I lived it.
But looking into the past
sure.
in the same breath.
Sure, that's what I mean. It repeats itself.
Now, he grew up in what town?
Monroe?
Yeah.
Monroe grew up, well, he was born in a small town on a farm in, I think it was Wolf Creek, Indiana.
Yeah.
About 75 miles from a town called Monrovia, by the way, at that point.
No relation to his family.
No, this was named after James Monroe, President James Monroe.
President.
There's lots of Monrovias across the country before this one even showed up. But his family moved to Iowa near Ottumwa shortly after that, and that's where he spent most of his childhood, went to school there, went to college from there for a couple of years, got a teaching credential, and then went to work as a teacher. Left that teaching job after less than a year to join the Iowa Volunteers.
Yes.
And then while he was at Fort Kearney in Nebraska, I think it was, doesn't matter, he was at Fort Kearney, and met a school teacher named Mary Jane.
Okay, which would later be his wife?
3 months later.
They
didn't waste any time at all. They got married on Christmas Eve, 3 months after they had met.
Now, how you parallel that with Atlas and Catherine? I thought that was quite interesting.
I was fascinated by that myself, honestly, because I had no idea about it going into it. Catherine Wilson bought the first piece of available land in Monrovia after Monroe subdivided it. She was the first person to buy into the new town. And I wondered about, we know that. I mean, that's in the record, and people who know the history of Monrovia know the name Catherine Wilson. But that's all I knew about her. And I wondered, who is this woman? Why is she buying a piece of commercial property in Monrovia? Why is she the first one to put her money down? I started looking at her. Catherine and Atlas Wilson led a life that paralleled the Monroes to a great extent. They lived, she was also born in Indiana, and her parents moved them out to Iowa when she was a child. They both of those families
loved. But they never met.
They never met. They never met until they got out here, apparently. They were living in maybe 100 miles apart, yeah. 30 miles apart, but they were always sort of,
wow.
They both came out here at the same time, both arrived in Los Angeles in 1875, first time here, both of them. They both lost a child at one point. There were just one parallel after another. And suddenly she's here in Duarte. She and Atlas own a branch, one of the first of the orange groves in Southern California was the Wilson Grove. Atlas passes away after a few years, mm-hmm. he dies. Catherine carries on with her, and she sits there and watches them put up a big house up on the hill and then start grading and subdividing land. And the people of Duarte are integral to this. They're, yes. they're all part of the story. They're the ones that are supplying food and things and supplies and such for the crew. Catherine comes in with the crowd from Duarte to see what they got to offer that day. She looks it over and puts on $150 and buys the southeast corner of Myrtle and Lemon.
Wow, prime spot.
Prime spot, right smack in the middle of what was to be the center of the core of the community.
So. Boy, did she have some vision.
She had a great deal of vision. That land that she bought for $150, she sold, was it 11 months later? Something like that, for $11,000.
Mm-hmm. A lot of money in those days.
A lot of money.
That
she decided there's more money to be made off that piece of land, bought it back again for $15,000. Ultimately lost most of that.
Wheeler and a dealer.
Yeah.
All right, now you said the magic name, the name that echoes money throughout the canyons and far down L.A. and beyond. That was Lucky Baldwin.
Yeah.
Tell us, the viewers, a little something about him and his connection with Monroe and the impact that he's had in the San Gabriel Valley and beyond.
Well, Baldwin was kind of a fun character to begin with. There's a whole lot of stories about him that will take me way off the track if I follow. But basically, he owned Rancho.
Stay in your lane.
Yeah. He owned Rancho Santa Anita, which took up all this territory. When he started selling it off, the first batch that he subdivided and sold off is now the city of Sierra Madre. After that came Monrovia. Then he started developing, he didn't develop Monrovia, but he sold it off to Monroe and Monroe's partners, who then laid out this subdivision.
The big four,
the local four. Yeah. Monroe, Spence, Bartle? No.
Bucknell?
Bicknell.
Okay. And Crank.
And Crank. James Crank.
I had the glasses.
And Falvey. James Falvey was part of that too. They brought him in because he was Baldwin's a foreman. And apparently, in lieu of salary, because Baldwin every now and then would run out of money, he gave him some land. That land happened to be that land is today bounded by Myrtle Avenue and Primrose Avenue, by Colorado and Foothill. So it's half of Old Town.
Yeah.
It was
prime spot.
Prime smack in the middle of what they wanted to subdivide and redevelop.
But what a luxury. I can't pay you, but what if I gave you a couple of acres of land?
Yeah. And he did a lot of that. The story is told, and it's in the book, that he offered land to his blacksmith at the time.
Yes.
Mr. Fisher.
Yeah. You're going ahead of me now.
Yeah, okay. And Mr. Fisher turned it down, said, I'll wait for the money. It's the money. That land is now called Baldwin Hills, mm-hmm. and includes the Inglewood oil fields.
Pumping
900 million barrels a year.
Didn't initially he give it to his son, thinking, this land ain't worth any
Could
money.
Be.
You can have this land.
I don't know.
That story.
There's a lot of stories that revolve around that one.
All right, moving right along. Let me jump over into, let's talk about the newspapers.
Yeah.
That's where you got a lot of your information,
yeah,
and newspaper at that time was the Monroe...
The planet.
The planet,
the Monrovia planet.
Yes.
James Harvey was the editor of the planet. He bought it about 6 months after it was founded. The guy that founded it decided there was more money in real estate, and he got in and
why
out
hang real, around with
real
this
fast. Thing. He was gone. Harvey took it over. Harvey was married to the daughter of Stephen Bowerman, who was a local landowner and farmer and such from Canada. He had come down from Canada years ago, and he had all kinds of kids. There's a Bowerman dynasty that comes out of Duarte and Monrovia now as a result of this. But Harvey came in from Canada with Bowerman's daughter, Elma. And they had an infant daughter at the time named Eva. He bought the Monrovia planet. And it was a one-man operation. I mean, he gathered the news, he sold the ads, he wrote everything, he set the type, he ran the press, and he got the stuff to the post office.
What was the price of a newspaper back then?
It was probably a penny or 3 cents,
what
something like that.
Did he make money?
A couple of dollars for a year's subscription. The dollar then is comparable to $27 today. So
it sort of worked out.
Yeah. So something that cost $10 then sounds cheap, but that was $270 equivalent to that today. So he made a living off of it because he was working like crazy and didn't have to split up that money. And they were living above the store basically.
Yes.
And by the end of the year, he had made enough money so that he was hiring people to run the press. He and his wife were building a house. He sold the building that they were in, and he moved to another building where he was renting, so he was cutting down on some of his expenses and getting some capital. And the man was a wheeler dealer in that regard. He made a real success out of it, but he worked his tail off, I can guarantee you, because I've done that, and it almost killed me.
I can
understand what he went through.
And he couldn't find a newsboy.
No, he couldn't find anybody to distribute the papers. The kids were having too much fun. Kids weren't working. They weren't interested. They were running wild all summer.
Yes, well, they come from wealthy families, the majority
of
them, right?
There was a lot of money in Monrovia at the time. Not everybody. I mean, there were social strata went all the way down to, there were homeless people here.
Tell me something about Colonel Kiefer.
Colonel Kiefer.
Yes, tell me about
Samuel
him.
Kiefer. Very wealthy man, came from the East, from New York. He had made a lot of money in the hotel business there, and he owned a lot of land there and in Mexico City. And I don't know where he got connected to Monroe, but he and his wife spent 3 months here as guests of Monroe while the subdividing was going on. So he was watching the whole thing, and he invested heavily, $100,000 or so of his money right off the bat at that time. He built the Kiefer Building, which was the first commercial building to go up, in addition to the hotel, the Monrovia Hotel that was going up then too. But that's where Barnes Hall was, Barnes dry goods store was in there. And upstairs of that was a large vacant room that was used as the town hall, or they called it Barnes Hall sometimes. A school was held there. They held important meetings there. The town gathered there for parties and entertainments and such. Kiefer built that. He also built the Grandview Hotel, which was a large luxury hotel that rivaled any of them in the area. Because believe it or not, there was a lot of tourist business out here even before the city was developing. People were coming out here for their health, or they were coming out here to invest. But there was They needed a hotel to cater to people with some money.
So how did the word get out about Monrovia?
They weren't shy about it. There was a lot of advertising that was done right off the bat in the Los Angeles newspapers and beyond. They advertised a lot in the East. People in the East were anxious for news about California because they all wanted to come here.
Booming state.
Yeah, so it was well known all over.
All right, tell me about this famous horse, J.I. Sell?
J.I.C.?
Yeah, J.I.C.
Yeah.
I'm not doing
J.I.C. was a trotter that broke world record and became a famous horse. It was used in product advertising. When the horse died, its obituary was in the New York Times. I mean, it was a famous horse. Its owner was named Jerome I. Case,
yes.
And that's where the J-I-C comes
okay.
from.
Okay, all right, right. Clever, clever.
Case was another one of those guys who, for some reason, got connected with Monroe, came out here and stayed at the Oaks at Monroe's place and said, this is a nice place, and I think I'll invest in it. And he bought a lot of land and bought and sold it and built a home here for the winter, and his home is still here. It was opened by the Hold Home Tour last year. Beautiful, huge, enormous place that he came out, spent 3 months of the winter in for 3 years before he died.
How nice.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
You have
the
that
man,
luxury.
Man yeah. had money. But they named the street that ran by the house J.I.C. Avenue after his horse.
After his horse.
And him. I mean, but,
okay.
but it was the initials J.I.C. Avenue.
Okay.
That's Alta Vista today.
Oh, I think Steve Baker did an article on that.
Yeah.
I'm
oh, yeah.
Pretty, I'm pretty
Steve
sure.
has done articles.
I'm
yeah.
pretty sure.
He's done articles on most
about
of the things.
General Powell, hero or villain?
Good question. Depends on which portion of his life you're talking about. General William Powell.
All right, break it up. Tell me something about
him. Quite a character. Led a battalion of black troops in the Civil War, and was very
Battle Mobile.
Battle Mobile. He was very instrumental in recruiting him, and was apparently instrumental in convincing the Army to put in black troops,
which was unheard of at the time.
At the time, yeah. So you know, hero in that regard, absolutely. Governor of the territory of New Mexico, where he takes a he takes a vice presidency at a land company, and then sets out burning all the deeds that from the Spanish land grants, so that would prove that maybe the land company didn't own the land that they claimed they owned, and he got fired because of that. General Grant by then had become president of the United States and had put him in that position, left him there for about a year, and then yanked him out of there. It was so controversial. He also put out an order to the local justice of the peace, who were sort of the local law enforcement people in the counties, to exterminate any Indians that they found marauding off the reservations. So,
all right, now that's an interesting question. Let me ask you this. Prior to when Monroe and others came out here, what Native Americans were here? It wasn't just all empty land, right?
Oh, here?
Yeah.
Oh, no, the Gabrielino Indians were here when the Spanish arrived. And then this became a Mexican territory.
Okay.
So there were still a few
Indians
left. Much
history of them?
Oh, sure. Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
So I was wondering how come some weren't incorporated in the book.
They were gone by then.
Wiped out?
Yeah, well, they were missionized by the Spanish.
Okay.
And, yeah, the culture and most of them were gone.
Compromised.
Yeah. There are Gabrielinos alive today in this
yes.
area, you know, and we've met them. I mean,
yes.
they're in town. But as a group, no, they weren't noticeable at the time.
Not
they had blended into what was then called the Mexican population.
Oh, okay. Okay, I had to get that out there.
Yeah.
All right, moving right along. If you just tuned in and you're wondering what's taking place, I'm interviewing Dick Singer on his new book, 1887. It's a very interesting read as we dive right back into it. If you wonder why I'm struggling a little bit, I forgot those things known as eyeglasses, okay? Banana Avenue, tell me about that. And why that peculiar name?
Banana Avenue is Hillcrest
yes.
today.
Yes.
It was called Banana originally because it was kind of shaped like this, but more to the point, for some reason they planted banana trees along both sides of the street originally, and they were harvesting bananas for a while.
Okay, and then
small but edible, they said.
Yeah, okay, small but eatable.
Yeah.
Appetizers, probably.
Apparently, yeah.
All right, so that name would change.
Yeah.
But you have to know that history of that name to know Hillcrest.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. All right. Thought that was an interesting tidbit. 1887, I have, was a busy year, and that the telephone came about.
Yeah. There was a telephone in town.
Okay.
And it was driving people crazy. because
why it didn't work or it's too busy.
You go down to Barnes Store and there's a woman sitting there at a telephone at a box with a speaker on it and such, and you'd tell her who you wanted to talk to, and she would call through Pasadena to say you want to call someone in Los Angeles, because there weren't that many phones anyway. Okay. You couldn't call anywhere but Los Angeles or Pasadena. It was if nobody else was on the
line. Oh, someone was on the line.
Someone was on the line. If Pasadena had a phone call for somebody, they just click it off, and you'd lose it halfway through. And James Harvey from the newspaper was complaining at one point that there were 20 messages or so that were piled up down there. They couldn't get through in the course of a day because it took more than an hour to get one across.
Sounded like a Saturday night skit.
Yeah,
instead of
the operator just screaming into the instrument, is the way you put it.
All right, tell me something about the first black resident in Monrovia that we know of.
Okay, they took me by surprise because I don't see them show up anywhere else. James Harvey was writing about them, I think it was 1904 or so. He was writing about the good old days.
Okay.
And he
okay.
mentioned that when Felix Monroe and his family, this is William Monroe's brother.
Yeah.
When the Felix Monroes moved in early on, and they brought with them their in-laws, they also brought with them two families of servants that had been family retainers for years. And those were the I'm gonna remember these names.
Thomas and Mary Dorsey
and James and Alice Buckner. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. I'm here to help you.
Yeah. Yeah. I was hoping to get it. The Dorseys had two children when they came in. The Buckners had one, and Alice was pregnant at the time. She was expecting, and she gave birth to Percy in 87, too. So he was the first black child born here.
All right, hold that thought. David has someone calling in.
Yes. Can you tell us more about Jeremiah Falvey, one of the original landowners of the area that became Monrovia?
Sure. Falvey, that was the fellow that I was mentioning that was the foreman for Lucky Baldwin, who owned that patch of land that is now half of Old Town.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Not much is known about him. He left his employ with Baldwin at some point and was living at the Jonathan Club in Los Angeles or in San Francisco. He was living at the Jonathan Club, I believe.
Okay.
At some point. And then a couple of years later at a rooming house in Boyle Heights, I think, is where he passed away. But not a whole lot is known about him.
All right, tell me about this lucky baby that got a gift of $150, which would be equivalent to like $4,000 today.
Yeah, see, that's what I mean about the difference in the money. You look at it and you say, they give the kid $150, isn't that nice?
Yeah.
And when you realize that that's the equivalent of $4,000, you say, wow.
Do the math, right?
Yeah, yeah, that was the first baby born in the new year, 1887, within the city of Monrovia.
Wow, amazing.
They did this for the next practically 100 years.
They had that type of money.
Oh yeah, in the 1940s, 1950s. But by then, the first baby born in town was getting a bunch of gifts from local merchants.
Oh, okay.
Which made it a little bit easier for any individual.
But. All right, tell me about the new teacher, Vesta Olmsted?
Vesta Olmsted?
Yeah, tell me about her.
Vesta was the teacher when they were in the,
You need water?
Yeah, I got some.
Don't save it.
When they were holding school in Barnes Hall.
Mm-hmm.
I can't even handle water.
Go ahead.
When they were holding school in Barnes Hall, up above the dry goods store, Vesta was the teacher. She had as many as 60 kids in the class when they broke for the summer. She was gone by the time the school reopened again. She sort of disappears too. They went through teachers like crazy.
Any reason why?
Maybe 60 kids.
Yeah, the classroom, Lord. And they come from the affluent families, so you had to be probably a little.
Things were very much in flux at that point, mm-hmm. anyway. But by the end of the summer, and by the end of the summer was October, by the time they got school started, they had a new school building, $18,000 in those dollars, and six classrooms and a big bell tower and a playground, and they had all that now, and they had four teachers. They also had 200 kids.
Ooh!
From 60 to 200 over the summer. That's how fast people moved in.
Wow, so Monrovia was like moving like a train coming into town with a load of people every time you turn around.
Every day the train would pull into the station and people would get off with their luggage looking for a place to buy or rent.
All right, now tell me something about the Great Divide as far as streets. I had that written down. Why do I?
Olive Avenue?
The Upper Avenue and the Lower Avenue.
Monrovia, like so many towns, is stratified and still is today to a great extent. Mm-hmm. You just look at it. Zoning does that. When it was laid out, the big lots were above White Oak Avenue, which is today Foothill Boulevard. Mm-hmm. Those are 5-acre lots that you bought up there, which meant you had to have some money to buy up there.
Yeah.
And you put up a big house on it. You put up a big garden, and you put up an orchard maybe, and you know, such. That's where Monroe built his house up north of White Oak. That's where the rich folk built. From White Oak south, then you're into the middle class, in the middle of the town. And you've got smaller residential lots that are deep because people had horses and they had chickens and they had cesspools and outhouses and such. So you needed some space, but they're not very, very wide. And a lot of people would buy those next near the commercial streets and then live above shops such. So you had your middle class developing in there, and that's where the churches were, and this is where the town hall was and the stores and such. South of that, as you're approaching the railroad tracks, once you get south of that, you're getting where now you're down where the planing plant is, where the lumber yard and such, the planing company, and who knows what else, the brick yard, probably down that way. And that's where the poor people lived. Those are the people who were working in the kitchens and were working in the maize. People of color were down that way.
Now, the Asian population that worked on the railroads, where was their location? Did they have a designated, or they were mixed in with the black and the browns?
There were 60 or so Chinese rail workers that Monroe brought in to lay out the land and such. They disappeared from the story at that point. I think they probably back to Los Angeles to the labor market there. There was a Soon Lee. Soon Lee
was
here.
Tell me a story. He was an interesting individual.
Yeah. Soon Lee was the local laundryman. There's always a Chinese laundryman in a community. Before the Chinese restaurant, there was the Chinese laundryman.
Right.
And it was their way of survival in that culture.
Now, someone told me he got in trouble for tossing water out on the street.
Oh, no, it wasn't that. What happened is that his cesspool kept overflowing because of the volume of water that he was putting into it. This was in years later where he had moved to another location, and the cesspool there wasn't adequate to what he was doing.
So he was the local rich folks' cleaning man.
To a degree, yeah. Well, yeah,
he'd take care of
their linen. And
now, did he have a family?
No.
He was just
a single man all by himself. But he was successful enough that he built his own building. It was valued at the time at $400, which means he probably spent $800 on it or something in that regard, which it wasn't a big house or anything, but it was a good-sized commercial building it would have been. And he probably lived in the back and had his laundry set
up
there.
Just faded into history?
Yeah,
no.
You know, as most of them do. But yeah, but he was there for again up until almost the turn of the century. There's still a record of him.
They tell me there was some. It was a vigilante-like action when it came to alcohol in saloons.
Oh, it wasn't vigilante-like. It was vigilante.
It was that simple.
They just walked in. Somebody would set up a bar and start to sell liquor, and they walk in and they say, go.
This ain't happening here.
This ain't happening here. And they put pressure on them, and you go. Usually it was...
So they would hide about through Monrovia selling alcohol?
No, I don't... Eventually, I think it got to that. Originally, it was just a merchant who was selling stuff anyway, put some alcohol in it. And says, nope, don't do that.
That new whiskey, put it on the table.
So, you know, they kind of turn the screw a little bit, and they back away. But then there's a lot of money to be made in alcohol.
Yes. Still is today.
Yeah, I'm saying there's a lot of money to be made in alcohol. And sooner or later, the pressure was great on it. And they had an incident where a guy set up a saloon, and they came in and said, leave. And he said, no. And he says, anybody tries it's going to have to talk to these two pistols I got behind the bar. So at that point, the vigilantes said, well, we're not going that far. And they backed off. They said, let's do this legal.
I want to live.
So they incorporated as a city.
All right, you spilled the beans too early on that now. All right, tell me about the Santa Fe. I think it was the train line. It was having trouble with that, right? Was it the Santa Fe line that was having trouble with?
People were having trouble with the railroads all the time.
It was outdated.
The Santa Fe took over what had been a local rail line, Los Angeles and San Gabriel Valley Railroad, which was Spence's railroad, What's his name?
Crank.
It was Crank's railroad.
Wealthy Three.
Yeah, and Crank sold it to Santa Fe, which needed to complete its cross-country line, and it was just the perfect spot to hook up with from San Bernardino, so they hooked up to his line at Pomona, and it got him through to L.A.
Wow.
So this was now the Santa Fe line, but they were still servicing local trains. Well, Santa Fe wasn't interested in the local business, so the service just kept getting worse and worse until they were driving people in Monrovia crazy because they charter a train, they pull all their money, real estate interests would pull their money, and they charter a train to come from Los Angeles, bring out people for open house at Monrovia, and they'd show off
great
the town.
Great PR and everything.
It was a big citywide effort, and the railroads wouldn't deliver. They'd show up late. The trains would run 2 hours late going back.
We're talking hot days also.
Yeah, and hot summer days. And people were just getting fed up with it. So some of the money men pooled their resources. They're talking to another group of men from Los Angeles and Pasadena and Alhambra, some real money men, some real power there, who were putting in a new rapid transit railroad. A light rail system, very much like
new metro.
They financed the last 6 miles of that out to Monrovia, and they built a rapid transit line to compete with the Santa Fe. And it did all right for a while. Never made enough to really do anything.
Yeah.
But it solved their immediate problem, which was they could go shopping or bring people out to buy either way. With some regularity and some assurance.
Serve that purpose for a moment.
Yeah.
All right, tell me something about this interesting individual, Dr. Stewart.
Charles or John?
I have an incident with Mr. Berger. I believe it was Berger or Bugger. Two fingers, he lost.
Dr. Stewart, Charles Stewart, was one of the first physicians in town. Mm-hmm. He suffered from tuberculosis, which is why he came to Southern California to begin with. But he was in practice here, and as his health started to decline, his brother John came out to join him in the business. He was also a doctor, and the two of them were among the three or four of the earliest physicians. Charles Stewart's the one who treated gentleman at the planing plant who got his fingers caught in the plane as he was working the power machinery there, and he amputated one of the fingers and part of the second one, saved that man's hand. He's also he treated the Homer Hull, the 2-year-old who was killed in the terrible accident. He treated the gentleman who was from Duarte who was kicked in the head by a horse. And suffered a terrible concussion for the second time in his life. It fractured skull twice.
So throughout the book, you peppered it with facts from history about different cases that the doctor that to deal with.
Yeah, that I thought were interesting and really indicative of the time, what the kind of hazards that people
faced. Well, like the two young men going camping up in the mountains, and then the first time they are found and they make it back okay.
Two different groups.
And then the second group, another group goes up there and
they don't get back.
They freeze to death, right?
Yeah, yeah. They froze to death in a snowstorm.
Oh, wow.
They got up high enough and picked the wrong day, and they got stuck up there and they found their bodies a few weeks later.
Never can estimate the power of the mountains of the weather.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. All right, tell me this guy here, Sheriff Oglesby.
I knew you'd come to him. One of my favorite characters.
He was an interesting character.
Yeah.
Tell me about Mr. Oglesby.
Captain Thomas Oglesby.
Confederate guy.
Yeah.
That didn't play. Went in a bar once and said he was going to do, where did I put that? Like, go ahead. Tell me something about Oglesby. I couldn't read it if I tried.
Okay. So. I'll tell you what. I'll skip through the Oglesby story. Oglesby was a former Confederate soldier, Sixth Georgia Sharpshooters, something like that. He may have been a prisoner of war. There's a lot about Oglesby I'm not sure about during that period, because there were two people named Thomas Oglesby that were in the Georgia Sharpshooters and keeping them straight was nutty. Anyway, he went on to become a member of the Texas Rangers.
Yes.
He rose to the rank of captain, so from then on
he was a pretty shady group back in the day.
Well, yeah. After that, he was elected sheriff of Maverick County, which is right on the Texas-Mexico border. In connection with that job, he had occasion to arrest and turn over a naturalized American citizen named Francisco. What's his name? Arasuras. Arasuras.
Okay.
Francisco Arasuras. He turned him over to the Mexican authorities, who wanted him for horse theft. The Mexican captain was Francisco Mondragon.
You know these people.
Mondragon, which is almost an evil name. It is Mondragon.
Okay.
And Mr. Asura says, please don't turn me over to him. He's going to kill me. Because they've had an ongoing thing their whole life.
He wants me.
Yeah, he wants me. Well, he's killed. He is killed. He's taken out at 1 o'clock in the morning, taken out of the jail cell, and killed while trying to escape with his hands tied and his eyes blindfolded. He was trying to escape.
Okay, that's a familiar ring. And
so the American consul in Mexico gets involved with this, and the governor of Texas gets involved with it, and the State Department gets involved with it, and everybody is involved with it. And before long, Sheriff Oglesby and the judge who signed the papers and the deputy who made the arrest are all under arrest themselves, charged with we don't know what at this point, but they were all ordered arrested by the governor. And they were taken to Austin and put in jail while the investigation went on. A grand jury refused to indict them, and so Oglesby goes back to Maverick County and assumes his duties, and the next day there's a knock on his door, and another deputy shows up and arrests him, and now he's being charged with embezzling $5,000 that was in his charge there in the office, and he's taken back to Austin to stand trial for that. He puts up bail. He says, I didn't embezzle his money. It was taken while I was under arrest for this other thing. How could I have done it?
So, can't be in two places at one time.
So he posts bail, and on the assurance from his bail company that it's not going to be a problem, they'll take care of everything.
Yeah.
He and his wife decide that they're getting out of law enforcement, and they're getting out of Texas. So they get on a train, and they come to Monrovia, where he gets a job with William Monroe as a real estate salesman.
Wow.
Yeah. In the meantime, The court in Texas says, what do you mean he went to California? So they send a deputy out to arrest him. He's out on a hunting trip up here in the mountains with some of the local, with the Chess brothers and one of Monroe's sons and such. And there's two deputies out here tracking him down. They find him, they take him back to L.A. and put him on a train, and they take he and his wife Helen, they go back to Texas, and he stands trial and he's found not guilty, and he gets on a train, goes back out here, resumes his career in real estate. We incorporate as a city. There's someone, it's not him, someone else is elected as the town marshal.
Okay.
And he is hired as the assistant, or the deputy marshal.
Deputy marshal.
He goes back into law enforcement on a part-time basis, becomes a deputy marshal. And as deputy marshal, he does a number of things, like they send him to fill a pothole on the street, which which I'm sure he wasn't thrilled about.
Yes, yes.
He was doing a lot of that kind of thing. Clean, make sure the cesspools are cleaned. And
Handyman
around town. But he's also the guy, when they outlaw saloons, you know, the guy with the two guns behind the saloon? Oglesby and three members of the new city council, and we're not sure who they were, but they were probably Pyle, Monroe, and it could have been Frank Myers.
Because Monroe would make the rounds.
Yeah, he was really into it. He was the one who was the vigilante originally. So he was probably in on this. So Oglesby and these three guys go into the saloon, and they order a beer, a glass of wine, and a shot of whiskey. And they sample each one. And they say, yep, that's alcohol. And Oglesby goes over to the bar, and he puts his hands on the bar, and he looks at the bartender, and he says, we all is incorporated, and we all don't want you here. Mm-hmm. Yours closed now. Boom. There's this imposing, nasty southerner.
Yeah.
And the guy's, okay.
I'm out of here.
Shuts down.
Shut it down.
2 days later, he's opened in Duarte. 2 weeks after that, he's got a permanent spot
in
Arcadia.
In Arcadia.
Yeah.
Okay.
And James Harvey says, well, we can't run the whole world.
Now, why were they so anti-alcohol?
Well, they were anti-alcohol to begin with, the people who were coming in here. It was Midwestern white middle-class Protestant temperance was really big at the time. Alcohol was a problem. It was way too much of some really bad stuff.
Overconsumption.
I've got the numbers in the book. Domestic consumption?
Abuse.
Oh, abuse. Everything.
Rampant.
Everything stemmed from that. Yeah.
Okay.
There's a story in there about a gunfight between Mr. Wardell and Mr. Dunn, because Mr. Dunn was a drunk and was abusing his family, and Mr. Wardell steps in. Mr. Dunn goes out and gets a gun, and they end up shooting at each other, and Dunn went to jail. That was alcohol. And that was starting to show up in Monrovia.
Which was the biggest drive to incorporate this city, right?
Yeah.
That was the drive.
Oh, yeah. They needed to take control anyway. They needed sewers. They needed to put in some decent streets. They needed to control zoning. There's all kinds of reasons to be a city. But what drove it was the alcohol.
Oh, okay. Okay. Moving right along. Where am I at now? Let's talk about this precious thing that everybody loves. Not alcohol. But what about good old-fashioned water?
Yeah.
Talk about that.
Well, the big sales point, besides the weather, was the availability of water. Mm-hmm. They had streams up in these hills, coming down from Sawpit Canyon, and from Cloverleaf Canyon, from San Anita Canyon, they laid pipe up there, captured the water as it came through these streams. I think there were five different streams. Put them into reservoirs, and then from there they were able to pipe the water to every lot in town.
So that was a unique luxury for Monrovia to tap into all this water,
sure,
right?
Sure. Yeah. The availability of the water was what made the town possible. It was what made the ranches and the farms and
flourish.
Yeah.
Tried to steal the water then?
Mr. Emerson and Mr. Mace up in Sawpit Canyon had some land up there. Apparently, they were squatters. They didn't actually have the title to the land, but they claimed title to the land, and they claimed that since the water was coming across their land, it was their water. And
so since it's passing through,
a couple of times they just diverted it so that it cut off water to the town and said, "Oh, would you like some water? Why don't you buy our land?" And they tried that sort of strong arm a couple of times before they were taken to court by the city, by Mr. Bradbury in Doherty and Mr. Baldwin in Arcadia. The three entities got together and said, this is enough of this. Took him to court, and the judge just brought the hammer down on him and said, stop. Mr. Emerson gave up all the plans he had for making his millions and bought a house in the town. He just moved down to the city and just became.
It's easier.
Yeah, I can't beat him. I might as well join him.
All right, tell me about the San Gabriel Valley Rapid Transit Railroad.
That's the one I was talking about. The one that is comparable to our Gold Line.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Making that little connection.
Yeah, they wanted it to be an electric railroad. At the time, electric railroads were starting in major cities. Like the Yells in Chicago.
Yes.
And really thought they were going to be able to do it. They were never able to pull it off, and so it was a steam-driven thing.
Well, you have a little footnote here also. It was invented by a lady.
Yeah.
Let's give her props.
Yeah, the Fisher system. A Miss Fisher apparently invented the electrical system that they wanted to use. It's the basic system of a charge cable, a third rail.
Okay.
Which, not the greatest idea, but they had worked it out.
And it worked.
It worked.
And improved transportation.
Yeah. Electricity was coming in. As I said, telephones were coming in. They finally solved that problem. They got a switchboard, and they got their own line coming through. Gas was coming in.
Yeah.
Gas heating and cooking. We were starting to modernize.
All right, tell me about Mount Wilson, the old name, and how it didn't make it to be the observatory, but go ahead, share that story.
Don Benito Wilson was a big landowner in the area and the grandfather of General Patton.
The General Patton.
He would get his timber from what became known as Wilson's Peak. Today we know as Mount Wilson.
What a way up there.
Way up there, yeah. He built the trail up there. People used to, at the turn, well, from the 1870s to about the turn of the century, it was a popular place to hike the trail, go up to the top and light a signal fire to let people know that you made it all the way up there. It was a popular spot. Edward Spence, who's one of the founders of Monrovia, one of the original Big Four of the Monrovia Land and Water Company. Wealthy man, banker, powerful, was the mayor of Los Angeles when Monroe was on the Los Angeles mm-hmm. Town Council. Spence gave a $50,000 bequest, that's $50,000 in those dollars, to the University of Southern California to put up a telescope, the latest, most modern telescope, somewhere in the Los Angeles area for the benefit of all mankind. Mm-hmm. And James Harvey in the Monrovia Planet lobbied heavily for it to be located on Mount Monrovia, just above where Spence's had built his home. That's above Sawpit Canyon, in other words, up on Mount Monrovia. He didn't get it. They put it on Mount Wilson, and that's the Mount Wilson Observatory today.
Yes. Yeah. Looking at history.
Yeah.
And not knowing the story, but now we do.
Yeah.
In a funny kind of way, we didn't get it, but
we helped pay for it.
Yeah. All right.
It said that for the original investors in Monrovia, like Spence, got $100 back for every dollar they put in. And nobody doubted it at the time. And so when I say that, you know, Monrovia paid for it?
Yes.
Quite possibly, that's where that $50,000 came from.
Now, tell me something, my notes are probably flipped, but tell me about the Monroe Lumber Company.
Yeah, he...
The Home Depot of the time.
Well, the planing plant had been there, they'd prepare boards for construction. And Monroe put together, he was doing this all over the place. He started the bank. I mean, there were land companies galore that he put together these partnerships. He put together a partnership with three or four other people, and they bought up the planing company there.
Okay.
So he was heavily, heavily invested in the development of Monrovia. He bought and sold the land. He bought and sold the lumber. It was He was,
Mr. Monroe was a, really a hands-on guy.
Oh, very much so. Yeah, a little too much so. He was so diversified and so busy, he had to start backing away from things. He finally gave up his real estate business when they formed the city, and he was now the mayor, in effect. It was just too much for him. He backed away from that. I think his health probably suffered, and I think that he ultimately, when the crash came, he lost everything because he put all of his money into the development of Monrovia, and that development stopped.
Called diversify.
Yeah.
And he didn't.
Others survived because they weren't that heavily or narrowly invested.
Well, tell me something about Mr. Studebaker and his letter to Monroe. That don't ring a bell?
Oh, Studebaker.
Yeah, Studebaker.
John Studebaker.
Yes, he wrote a letter to Monroe that was pretty.
Insight. He was another one. Here's a multimillionaire owned the Studebaker company. I mean, they built the wagons that the White House used. This is before they built cars. They built the wagons that Budweiser uses. The Clydesdale pulled Studebaker wagons. They were the largest wagon manufacturer in the country. They built a 10-story building on Michigan Avenue in Chicago, where they built a sleds, for winter sleds. Studebaker came out, and he was another one of his Monroe's guests for a while. Yeah,
money,
exactly.
Money.
And he built a home here. He spent his winters. He was going to spend his winters here too, and did. And he wrote a letter to Monroe with some advice on it. And be careful where you put the cemetery. You know, you don't want the town to grow up around it and find yourself with a cemetery in the middle of the town. Make sure you got parks. American cities always make the mistake of not putting in parks.
Which is so true.
It's true. And they didn't have parks. They didn't put in parks for another 10 years.
Oh, didn't think they were vital. Precious land.
Yeah. Yeah.
Who needs a park when I can have a storefront right here, right?
But at that point, they didn't need parks because they had wide open fields everywhere too.
But once
it developed, then they said, "Oh shoot, you know what we forgot?"
Yeah. Then I'm just thinking, well, most of the homes were big as a park.
Some of those with five acres of land, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, they're telling me the hands of time. It's time to wrap it up, believe it or not. But I want you to close with reading this part right here. On Mr. Monroe, and that's on page 83, he gives a description right from starting there. You close it out with that, face the audience right there. And
this is the first anniversary celebration of the founding of the community. 1 year after that, Catherine Wilson bought that first lot.
Yes.
They had a party up in Barnes Hall, and the hall was packed. There, people were standing in the back. A hush fell over the room as William Monroe walked onto the stage. Tall, solidly built and mustachioed, the red hair of his youth now aged to a dignified auburn, the 45-year-old was an imposing figure despite his somewhat casual nature. And as the town's founder, principal manager, banker, school trustee, streetcar developer, foremost booster, leading saloon fighter, and generous benefactor, he quite naturally enjoyed the residents' respect and admiration. Although he had no official title, and there was no city government as such, people have begun referring to him as Mayor Monroe. He smiled down on his assembled family and neighbors. Holding out his arms in a gesture of inclusiveness, Monroe welcomed all to the anniversary celebration. The old settlers, he said, as well as the strangers who sojourn within our gates. He spoke for several minutes, recounting a time when the town site was but a home of sagebrush and cactus, explaining how the idea of establishing a town evolved, detailing the clearing of the ground and surveying of the properties, the lots being plotted and streets graded, water piped all over the place, and shade trees planted. He spoke of populating the community, how the first settlers came little by little, then in large numbers. It had only been a year, he reminded them, and already there were upwards of 1,000 inhabitants of this new town. People, he said, who have selected this spot above all others in this lovely valley in which to make their future homes.
All right, so it's, in a lot of ways it rings true today in so many different ways, the vision that he had and what he thought the city should be.
Oh,
and
yes.
I think pretty much in so many ways it's that today.
Hasn't been easy, but
not always
successful.
It never will be easy.
But I think he'd be happy with most of the result.
Yes. All right. They're telling me time to wrap it up. I want to thank you so much for being here. To the viewers out there, I want to tell you, if you're looking for an interesting read for this summertime of so much time to do something, pick up the book, 1887. You'll be surprised what you will find in the inside. Thank you once again, Dick.
Thank you.